Baruch Hashem, we're here again, Nefesh HaChaim, in chapter 11, Yud Aleph, of the second part. Okay, this is very important secret. Everybody wants to know, what can I do to make my income double? Yes? So, the sages are telling us the secret. How to double your income? So the secret is, kol ha-meshatef shem shamayim b'tzaro, anyone that is putting the name of Hashem inside of his pain, on his, inside of his affliction, koflim lo parnasato, he makes double his income. He will double his income. You want to double your income?
No, you don't understand.
If you say no, you don't understand. Huh? You want your income to be double?
Okay, entra.
Yes?
Supervision.
Dineros.
Yeah, no.
You want to make income double?
Que si quieres que el dinero.
You want, no, yes? Okay. So the secret is, regga, first double. Then you can make the double, but first double. So the secret that the sages are telling us, this is the beginning of this chapter here, which is connected to what we were speaking yesterday, is that kol ha-meshatef shemayim b'tzaro, when you have pain, instead of saying, oh, I'm so miserable, this, that, you say, oh, Baruch Hashem, thank you Hashem for giving me this pain and not something else that is worse. Thank you Hashem, I know this is the best thing for me. This is called meshatef shem shamayim b'tzaro. When you have pain, he remembers to say, Hashem, thank you.
Before or after?
Within the pain. Within the pain. He feels the pain. He has suffering. He lost money. Something like this. Something happened that it looks like a negative thing. And instead of feeling pity on himself, feeling bad, depressed, this, that, he's saying, thank you, Hashem. I know this is the best thing for me. This is the sgula of the sages. Of receiving double income. Okay? Koflin lo parnasato. So now the Nefesh HaChaim is explaining the what is the idea here. Ha'inyan ki milvad ze hatzar shenesa lemala kshemekabel onsho biyisurim rachmana litzlan. Okay? So we spoke yesterday that when a person have pain, Hashem is putting himself like a partner of the pain. So, yes, Hashem doesn't want us to have pain. Hashem wants to have pleasure. If someone has pain, so Hashem is feeling with him the pain. Okay? So it says, En aroch v'dimyon klal, ze atzar shel mala kenegit otzem atzar shigaram lemala b'et asoto ha'avon rachman alitzlan. So, why? What's the reason that a person have pain? What's the reason? Because he made a sin before that. He was not acting properly. Right? So Hashem is suffering twice. Hashem is suffering because the person did the sin, while he's doing the sin. And then, when the punishment for the person comes, so Hashem is suffering again because of the pain of the person. The person is suffering one time. Hashem is suffering twice. Right?
Kinyan ben yakir shenitpata
beino venafal haaretz venishbar mefrakto vegufo vehu mesukan. So, there is a parable. Something is not going with the connection here.
Double
income. I pay you twice today. So there's an example of a person of the son of the king that he got drunk. Yes? The son of the king got drunk. and he fell on the floor and he broke his neck. But he's so drunk, he doesn't feel the pain. Okay? So, what's going on? The son that gets the punishment, he doesn't feel the punishment. Right? Achinoti bal chilati, halmuni bal yadati. There's a pasuk in Mishlei. That a person that is getting hit, getting hitted, and he says,
can you close everything?
He says, I didn't become sick, and I get hit, and I don't feel, I don't know about it. Okay, but what happens to the father? What happens to the king? The king, he sees the son that he have broken neck, so the king is crying. Oh, my son, what happened to you? What happened to you? So the father, the king, he feels the pain. The son, that it happened to him, doesn't feel the pain because he's drunk from the wine. וכאשר רופאים קשרו השברים והניחו רדיעה ותחבושת וסמנים חריפים, והבן צורח, והבן מר צורח על הכאב שלו מהסמנים החריפים האוכלים בשרו, then the father is putting the son on the bed and calling all the doctors of the kingdom, and everybody is taking care of the son. In the meantime, the wine go away. So the son, now he feels the pain. And the doctors are putting bandages and putting all kinds of spices, very, very strong, like burning kind of ointment on the skin of the son. So he's crying and screaming from pain, right? But the father is feeling bad that his son is screaming. But now he knows that the doctors are helping him. So in one side he's sad because of the pain of the son, in the other hand he's happy because he knows that now the son will get better. Will get refuah. ואם כי אביו מצטער לצעקתו ורבות החנרות, אב אתה אין ארוך כלל הצער של אתה כנגד הצער והיגון הראשון שהיה לאביו בעת שנפל ושיבר עצמותיו, אשר כמעט נתייאש מחייו אז. Right? When in the time that the son was drunk and he fell down, so then the father, he had much more pain. Then afterwards, when the son is aware, because the wine went away, and then the son is screaming. Yes? Okay? על כן ממש על זה האופן הוא העניין אבון רחמנא ליצלן שבעת שהאדם עושה הוא גורם למעלה צער גדול. So this is what happens when someone is doing a sin. When he's doing the sin, so he doesn't aware of what's going on, like someone that is drunk from the wine. So most of the people, they are drunk from the sin, from the Yetzer Hara that makes them blind. So they don't feel anything. They don't aware of what's going on around them. But Hashem is crying for them. While they are doing the sin, Hashem is crying, oh, my son, why are you doing this? Why are you falling down like this? שבעת שהאדם עושה הוא גורם למעלה צער גדול ועצום לאין ארוך והאדם עצמו אינו מרגיש אז בזה כלל ולא ידע כי בנפשו כי הוא נחשב אז כמת חס ושלום. Right? The people that are wicked, רשעים בחייהם, נקראים מתים. Wicked people, while they are alive, they are called dead. Okay? So someone that is going against the will of Hashem, even though maybe in the morning he was tzaddik, getting up for Shacharit, putting on tefillin, whatever it is. But if the Yetzer Hara took over him and he's making a sin in the afternoon, so in that moment that he's doing the sin, he's like wicked. So if he's wicked, in that moment he's dead, spiritually. So the king, Hashem, he sees his son dead. What happens to a father that he sees his son dead? Screaming, crying, right? ומאמרם ראשי מחייהם הוא ימתים ויש הבנות של ידיהם נפשו נקראתת לגמרי חס ושלום מתגשרות חבל הקדושה. Right, and we spoke today, I don't know, today it's a interesting life, ברוך השם. So when someone is doing sin, that the punishment is karet. So the way that the Nefesh HaChaim explains what is karet in the beginning of the book, in the first part of the book, it means that the person is cut off from his spiritual source. Okay? In other words, there is many, many tendons, channels, that connects the person, the neshama of the person, with the source of his neshama. And when a person is doing karet, he's cutting the connections. If he's going on one karet, so one channel. But if he's doing more and more sins, so he's cutting more and more channels. Okay? So when a person is doing something like that, he's cutting himself away from Hashem, basically. אבל הוא התברר שמוע ורחמן, כביכול בצרתו לא צר. Obviously, Hashem is crying for that. Hashem is sad for that, right? It's painful. מרוב רחמה וחסדיו התברר שמוע, שולח לו איסורין השם מהמרתיה ותרבושת למראה כוונו. So Hashem wants the son to be healthy. So he's sending the doctors. Right? What is the doctors? That now we have affliction. The son have affliction, right? They putting all kinds of bandages and all kinds of very strong and burning ointments. So then the son wakes up from the wine of the Yetzer Hara, starts to scream, ah, pain, pain. Now he feels the pain. When he was doing the sin, he didn't feel anything. Now he feels the pain because he has affliction in his life. He has suffering in his life. So he's screaming. But all of those afflictions is to make him healthy. It's because of the mercy of Hashem that he has to suffer that. But even so, even it is the right thing to do, and that's what will make the son healthy again. When Hashem sees his children crying from pain, he feels with them. He's like a partner with them, with their pain. Because Hashem doesn't want that they will. But right now, this is the situation. That's what has to be done. But that's not what Hashem wants. אמנם נרוך כלל זה הצער כנגד הצער שגרם למעלה בעת עשותו אהבון חס ושלום. Right? So the pain, the second pain, from the suffering of the affliction is less than the pain that there was for Hashem from the sin that the son was doing. לכן כשכל תכלית תפילת האדם לפניו יתברך שמו להסיר מעליו צערו הוא רק על הצער של מעלה משתף עמו בצערו. So again, same principle that we spoke about yesterday. When a person he wants to pray to Hashem to take out the suffering from his life, so what should be the intention? Because his pain makes pain in the heavens. So when he's praying to Hashem, take out my pain, he should think in his mind, why I don't want the pain? Because I don't want to have that to be a reason for pain in the heavens. ושאר הוא מתחרט באמת על אבונו שגרם על ידו הצער של מעלה. So when the son is doing תשובה, repenting on the first acts that he did, אז ההיסטורים מסתלקים מעליו. Then all the affliction goes away. ולא עוד לשם עוד הדין לו כמידתו וכופלין לו פרנסתו. And then it goes back to the original point that we were speaking. What does it mean that they make his income double? Why, when he's remembering to Hashem, when he has the pain, it makes his income double? Why? כנגד הבית מיני צער שגרם למעלה. Because when he's doing the sin, he had one kind of pain. He was a cause, he was the reason of one kind of pain in the heavens. And then when he gets his punishment, he gets his... causing a different kind of pain. So then when he's doing tshuva, repenting, within his pain, from his pain, so he's canceling those two pains of the heavens. Right? And if he's tshuva me'ahava, he's repenting from love to Hashem, so it will be even stronger, that the sin becomes to be like a merit. And then, for sure, it will be double. Ela shedarshu chazal b'chana v'imarat nefesh b'tbalel Hashem shetichah dvarim klapei ma'ala. Okay? Now, there's a big question. We know, I said a few times, that we're learning the prayer from Chana. Right? Chana went to the Mishkan to pray, to have a son. Right? And we're learning how to pray Amidah, silent prayer from Chana, the prayer of Chana, right? Vatitpalel Chana. So it says, Vehi marat nefesh. It means that Chana had bitterness within her. Her prayer came out from bitterness of the heart. And Chazal, the sages, telling us that that means that she was. Hatiach dvarim klapei mala. What does it mean? Latiach dvarim klapei mala. Latiach means like to throw. So she was throwing her words to Hashem, like because she couldn't take it anymore. It was like too much, too much. I can't take it. She was like, yes, it's a certain kind of attitude, of certain approach. צריך לומר, גם שהיא עצמה הייתה מרת נפש, עם כל זה השליחה בצערה מנגד ולא אכפת לה להתפלל על זה כלל, אלא שהתיחה התפילה, דברי תפילתה לפני השם, דברך על שמוע על הצער של מעלה נעשה מחמת שישויה אתה בצער. So the נפש החיים is explaining beautiful explanation. What does it mean שהתיחה דברים כלפי מעלה, that she was throwing her words up above to Hashem? Why? Because she was not thinking about herself. She was not down and depressed within herself from her pain, from her perspective. She was putting her heart to Hashem. She opened up her heart and spoke out to Hashem. Hashem, I don't want you to be in pain. So she was praying for her needs in a way of the need of Hashem. Because Hashem doesn't want her to be in pain. לכן אמרו שם שגם משה תיאר דברים כלפי מעלה, אל תקריא אל השם אלא על השם. And the same thing is also about Moshe Rabbeinu. Obviously, it is very difficult to say such a thing. Right? If the sages would not say that, we could not say that. But it's a clear midrash. So he says that because we understand by Chana that hetichah dvarim klapei mala, to throw the things, to throw the pain up above, it's a good thing. Ma'aliyuta. It shows the mightiness, it shows the strength. of Hannah. That she had the understanding how to pray. From her we're learning how to pray, right? So the same thing is about Moshe Rabbeinu. And that also proves about Hannah that what she did, it was positive. Right? The simple understanding without this midrash is that it looks like negative. La'atich dvarim klapei mala, you think it's not a good thing, it's like complaining. But we learn from this midrash and with the explanation of Nefesh HaChaim that this is the right thing to do. That all the pain that a person have, all the bitterness that a person have, to put it, to hang it on the heavens. Okay? ואת פני מבין להבין על דרך זה מה שאמרו שמות שגם אליהו תיך את הדברים כלפי מעלה שנאמר ואתה סיבות לי בא מאחורנית. Okay, the same thing also about Eliyahu Navi. Eliyahu Navi, when he was praying to Hashem on the Jewish people, he was saying, Hashem, you put the heart of the Jewish people away from you. So it's like he's complaining on the way of Hashem, that Hashem is treating the Jewish people. Right? But really, that's a simple understanding. But according to what we explained, it is the same principle. That he was crying to Hashem, Hashem, you should not be in pain because of the state of the Jewish people and the way that it will be fixed is if you will accept my prayer and the Jewish people will see the miracle and bring back their heart to you. Okay? This is the source for us to learn how to pray. Okay, so the Nefesh HaChaim is saying also about David the Melech, Tzur Levavi, this is the same understanding. And we have all kinds of sources from the Zohar and the writings of the Arizal. That he brings, that like I said many times, Be'ezrat Hashem, next time we'll read the Nefesh HaChaim, we can open those sources and speak about them. Bili neder. Ve'im b'inyan tfilat ha'echid al tzaro. If we say that about a single man that he prays for his pain, tzarich shetei kavanato rak tzorech gavo levan, that all of his intention, all of his meditation while he's praying, should be that his head should be in the heavens. And even though he's feeling pain, he should not think about his own pain, he should think about the pain in the heavens.
That means that because of his pain, the heavens have pain?
Yes.
So he should think, not to take away his pain, but because of the...
To take away his pain because it's causing pain for the heavens.
Because Hashem doesn't want to give pain to people.
כל שכן במטבע ברכות ותפילה גבוהות בסדרו אנשי כנסייה הקדושים ודאי ראוי שלא לכוון בהם כלל צורך עצמו הנראה מפשוטם אלא צורך גבוה לבד. Right? So when we say the עמידה, when we say רפאנו השם ונרפא, right? And you, חס ושלום, you or someone close to you is sick. So you can think in the simple way, Hashem, I want to be healthy. I want my family to be healthy. This is the simple understanding. Nefesh HaChaim says, no, it is not the right intention. You should think about that if you don't feel well or if someone around you doesn't feel well, it's causing pain in the heavens. So, Refa'enu Hashem v'nerafeh, please send us the refuah, send us the healing, because we don't want you to be in pain.
Insof or yudkei vav? Okay.
להמשיך תוספת ריבוי ברכה וקדושה על העולמות מצד התחברותו יתברך שמו אליהם. So what we are trying to do again, like we said many times, to add more קדושה into the heavens, into the spiritual world, to bring more light to the spiritual world. ואף שגם רזל אמרו יכולני לבדור את כל העולם מדין תבילה שנאמר שקורת ולא מיין ומה נאמרת בדורות הללו, אשר גוליש הוא כשוכב בראש חבל ובלב ימים, כל עמים מאור הגיעות הפרנסות, right? So, there is a saying in the Gemara of Eruvin, that Eruvin, that one of the rabbis there says, I can exempt all of the Jewish people, all of the world, from judgment. Why? Because everybody are like drunk. All of the humankind, all of the people around the world are like drunk. They have no common sense, they have no mind, they cannot think. Everybody are so like flipped with their mind that they are not responsible for the acts, basically. She called Kulam Yain. And the Nefesh HaChaim says that was in the time of Chazal. What we will say, this is the Nefesh HaChaim, right? About 400 years ago, something like that, right? So the Nefesh HaChaim says, what will we say in our generation? That there's so much Yetzer Hara and the yoke of the Parnassah, and everybody, they don't have the right set of mind to be able to serve Hashem. And if he says it, the Nefesh HaChaim in his generations, so how much more we have to say that? 20 times, 1,000 times more, right? Right? It's a miracle that we are here learning Torah. With the state of the world today, it's like it doesn't make sense. How can a person sit down and learn Torah? Right? Miracle. How much we have to thank Hashem that we are here?
This is the problem in this generation. Yeah? The distraction, what happened? The internet. Yeah? The internet is
too much light.
There's many, many things. It's not one thing. It's a combination of a whole big, long setup. But this is the purpose of the creation, right? It's not something that happened by coincidence.
Yeah.
This is the plan of Hashem. Right? The dawn, the light of the morning, should rise up from total darkness.
Yeah.
Right? So there's a concept, it's called Kadruta de Tzafra, the darkness of the morning. The darkness that comes before the light. Okay? So this is our generation. Kadruta de Tzafra. That all of the most crazy things that people can do, there is in the world. There's not one thing that you can think of that there's no a person that doing it. The most crazy thing, whatever you think, there's nothing you can think about that doesn't exist in the world yet. Nothing. I promise you. I didn't check it, but I promise you. So you see that the world getting to such a high level of craziness that it's like there's nothing more. You can't think about anything else more than that. It's getting to a point that's it. There's no more ideas of getting more crazy. No one can think about things like a new thing, a new craziness. Nothing. Everything already be done, right? So this is like the depths of the darkness, and then from that darkness comes the light. And what is the light? Or Chadash al Tzion Ta'ir, right? Where the light is coming from? Tzion, right? Or Chadash, Tzion Ta'ir starts from Tzion, Har Tzion, right?
It started here. The Baal Teshuva movement started here.
Right. So it's a miracle. It's a big miracle for us to be here.
Amen.
So it says. אשר כל, כן? לזאת אין איש שם הלב לפנות ליבו ומחשבתו מבבלי תרדותיו העצומים בבלי זה העולם השפל להכין עצמו לקראת אלוקיו יתברך שמו. Right? So that's why, because there's so many troubles to all the people, everybody are so troubled with this and that and all kinds of pains and sufferings and troubles of parnasa and health and marriage and children and fathers and sons and everybody have so many troubles that no one is really have the time to put his heart of Hashem, to Hashem, right? because there's so much confusion and problems. ואם כל זה ודאי שכל אחד לפי זכלו והשגתו מחויב להשית עצות בנפשו ולבקש תחבולות מלחמת מצווה. So even though with all of those problems and all of the excuses that we have, which is true, all of those things is true, it's happening. We have that in our life. So we have all the reasons to say, Hashem, I can't do it. But with that, we are obligated to look and to search for different ways to solve all of those things, at least for a moment, to put our heart, that it will be free, to put our mind to connect to Hashem. This is our obligation.
That's manner. For ourselves.
Okay. Right? We have all the excuses, and everything is true.
Yes.
But if a person with that is pushing all of those excuses aside, and is doing his obligation to connect to Hashem, this is the test. This is the even if it will be only for a split of a second. Even if it will be only for one second a day, it's already worth it for Hashem. להימלד מבלבול המחשבות אשר לא תיאורים. Right, one of the big problems of our generation is the thoughts, the impure thoughts. Okay? The because the problems of that tzniut, because of the problems of that tzniut in the world, that there's so much lack of tzniut, so the mind of the people is getting crazy from the yetzer hara. So to stop that, it's like a flow of thoughts that comes blowing into the mind. So to stop that and to have a clear mind for a few seconds, it is very hard. But this is the obligation. That's what we have to do. שתכונן דעתו עליו לעבודת התפילה כראוי. At least when we pray, at least when we say the name of Hashem. כי עבודת התפילה היא לנו עתה במקום עבודת קורבן. Why? Because when we are serving Hashem by prayer, it comes instead of serving Hashem in Bet HaMikdash. Right? Can you imagine yourself the Kohen in Bet HaMikdash that is doing the sacrifice and he thinks about bad things? Obviously not. Right? The Avodah of the Korbanot, doing the sacrifices, have to be pure, with all of the clear, pure state of mind of the Kohanim, right? So now we are the Kohanim, we are doing the Avodah. So in the sacrifices, שהיה תלוי כולו במחשבתו של הכהן, שבמחשבתו היה יכול לפגלו, right? You know what is pigul? Pigul. There's a concept in the Gemara of Zvachim that if the Kohen is doing a sacrifice, and while he's doing the sacrifice, he thinks to eat the meat not in the right time or not in the right place, it becomes to be pigul. What does it mean, pigul? That if someone will eat it afterwards, even though it will be in the right time, in the right place, the meat is forbidden because it's pigul. If someone will eat it, he will have karet.
It's kemo patul.
No, it's like what?
Because part of the turma or what?
No, not turma. There is a sacrifice. Okay, for example, let's say Reuven made he brings a korban todah. Okay, the korban todah have to be eaten in a certain place in a certain time. The kohen that is doing the shechita, while he's doing throwing the blood, for example, yeah. So he thinks, oh, in Shabbat I'm gonna have guests. It would have been so nice to take some of the meat of this sacrifice to my house, to eat it in my house outside of Yerushalayim with all the family and the guests. I don't have meat in my house.
Meat in Lashon, for example.
So he thinks about a thought that is not the right process with this sacrifice. So the sacrifice immediately becomes to be pigul. So even though after he finished, he was thinking to himself, what I was thinking about when I was doing the sacrifice. For sure he doesn't do it. He does tshuva immediately. But their sacrifice is already pigul. Because when he was drawing the blood on the altar, he had the wrong thought in his mind. That's it. The korban, this korban is pasul, pigul. It is not good korban. If it was an obligation, the owner have to bring another korban. If someone will eat this meat, he will get karet. It's a terrible sin.
So what do they do when this happened with the meat?
They burn it.
What is the situation in the ruin, for example?
It's a problem. If they know, so they have to tell Reuven, we're sorry. You have to go to bring another korban.
So
it's a big problem. But the point is, there is many halachot around it. I'm not. It's not
a shiur of the Chidna. We're not talking about the concept.
Yes,
of correct.
Yes. The point that I want to make is that in the time of Beit HaMikdash, in the sacrifices, so if someone, one of the Kohanim here had the wrong thought in the wrong time, it will ruin the whole Korban. The whole Korban have to be burned, not in the altar, in Beit HaMoked, and the owner have to bring another Korban, and if someone will eat this meat, he will have karet. So it's a big problem, and it's all about the thought of the Kohen. So if now we understand that when we pray, it comes inside of the sacrifices, how much we have to be aware and careful with our thoughts. What we have in mind when we're praying, right? So if a person is not aware of that, okay, whatever it is, thinking, not thinking, the right thought, not the right thought, just I have to say those words and that's it, and I can run away. So it's almost impossible to have the right state of mind. Even when a person is aware of all of that and is making an effort to have the right thoughts, even then it's very hard. But when a person is not aware of that, for sure he would not have the right thoughts when he's praying. Obviously. Right? That's why it's very, very important to know those things and to have time of preparation for the prayer before the prayer. Mm-hmm. Not to jump into the prayer. To have a preparation. Right? You cannot start Amidah jumping into the Amidah. You have to have time. Right? So in Shacharit we have a long time of Korbanot Zmirot Yotzer. In Mincha it's a little bit shorter. Only Korban HaTamid, Ktoret, Asherei Yoshevei Beitecha. It's not a lot so much, but anyhow you have a certain time to prepare yourself. Right?
Most of Derech Hashem is really just leading up to the final part when it talks about the prayer.
Okay.
It's a preparation, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Is that? על ידי קדושת מחשבתו היה קורבן מתעלה לריח ניחוח לפניו יתברך שמו. So when it is positive, when it is the right side of mind, so then the korban becomes to be the best fragrance for Hashem. So also when we pray to Hashem, when we have the right side of mind, that's what Hashem he appreciates and desires the most. Okay? So now, let's continue to speak about prayer with the Sidur Zichron David a little bit. And what the last time I told you, we will learn about Asherei Yoshevei Beitecha, right? So I'm in page 111, 111, Asherei Yoshevei Beitecha. So first of all, you know, that in Asherei Yoshevei Beitecha you have the alphabet, right? Aromimcha is aleph. Then Bechol Yom, Bet is Bet, right? Then Gadol Hashem is Gimel, and so on. We have all the alphabet except of Nun, like you said. Okay, that's one thing. That's the Gemara in Masechet Berachot speaks about. But this you can find in any Siddur. Here in this Siddur you have something extra. That you have 10 times the name of Hashem within Asherei Yoshevei Beitecha. So every time it comes with different nikud, right? Asherei Am Shikach Alo Asherei Am She Hashem. So there Hashem is with Kamatz. Yes? She Hashem Elokav. Tehila Redavir Omcha Elokai Melech Mevachashimcha Lolam Ad Bechol Yom Vachay Gavar Elohim Gadol Hashem. Gadol Hashem. is with Patach. Right? Mm-hmm. So if you go through the Mizmor of Ashrei in the Sidur Zichron David and other Sidurim of Kavanot, of Jewish meditation, you see that it goes one by one, every time they have the name of Hashem, it has a different nikud. So many people that they have nothing to do with the Kabbalah, or they want to have something but they didn't learn yet, so they ask him, why every time you have the name of Hashem with different nikud? Decide. What is the right nikud? Why are you doing every time something else? Right? One time I gave my Sidur for someone to make a type editing. He didn't understand it. He thought it was a mistake. So he fixed all the name of Hashem within the Sidur that everything will be equal. I tell him, what you did? Now you have to go to do it all again because every nikud is different sphira. Okay?
Bin the Etz Chaim or
yes. Keri? Yes, yes, yes. So it goes by the order of the Sefirot, right? The first is Keter, is Kamatz. No. Then we have Patach, is Chochmah. No. Then we have Tzereh, is Bina. Okay? Everything is in the order. So you have 10 times the name of Hashem, every time, different Nikud, and it goes in the order of the Sefirot. Okay? Keter, Chochmah, Bina, Chesed, Gvurah, Tiferet, Netzach, Hod, Yesod, Malchut. Okay?
Hoshiah.
Ma?
But only on the Ashrei.
Only on Ashrei.
Because in Shemoneh Ashrei is different.
Yeah, right.
At the end, you
show the Remez Ledat the Ashrei? Yes, Remez
Ledat. No. Okay. That's a general question. When we count out, when we don't count out, it's a different class.
Okay.
Bezrat Hashem, we'll get there. Anyhow, so you see that when a person knows a little bit those concepts, so even just one mizmor of Ashrei Yoshevei Beitecha, you can go in your mind a whole meditation of the 10 Sefirot to go from the Keter all the way down to the Malchut, right? So simply, when you have something like that, what does it mean? Simply, we want to bring the abundance from the highest level to the lowest level, from the Keter to the Malchut, to bring the abundance, right?
That's why it's a Parnasa Tehillim.
And within that, we have the Pasuk of the Parnasa, Patech et Yedecha u'masbi'a lekol chayei ratzon, that really I already gave a shiur on that, but I will say it again in short now. So, if you look it here, it's 112 in the Sidur. So you have, first of all, you have the word poter. Okay, so the word poter is gematria. Okay, it has gematria of 378 plus 54 plus 65. So there is a little mistake. The number got switched. Instead of 378, it says 873. Okay? It's a mistake. Anyhow, so the 378 is the source of a certain abundance, which is coming from a very high source. Okay? I'm not going in to explain all of the details around it. There's a lot. But let's put it this way. It's bringing a very, very high level of abundance. There is a concept that is called Sha'ach. It's Gematria Sha'ach. 378. So this Sha'ach is a very, very high level of, let's call it energy, that comes down. Where it comes down to? So then we have another two Gematriot of 45. 45 is the name of Hashem with, when you expand the letters, so the Yud, you write Yud Vav Dalet. The Hey, you write Hey Aleph. The Vav, you write Vav Aleph Vav. The last Hey, you write Vav Hey Aleph. So this, all of this is Gematria 45. Okay, so the name of Hashem, when you're doing it 45, this is representing the male aspect.
Adam.
Okay, it's also the Gematria of Adam. Then we have the Gematria of 65. 65 is the Gematria of the name Adni. Okay, Adni, 65. So we bring this high abundance, high level of energy, into the masculine, which is the name of Hashem with the this gematria of 45, and to the feminine, which is the Adni. Okay? So this is the meditation of the word poter. One word. Okay? Then we have et yadecha. So if you make the Rashi Tevot of poter et yadecha, this is one of the names that is Sgula for Parnasa. This name is Sgula for Parnasa. You have it here in the Siddur.
This is one number, the okay. 17 numbers?
This is the this is number 91. 91 is also the gematria of Yud Kei Vav Kei with Adni together, the combination. Right? Amen, also, 91. Every time we say Amen, also it's one of the meditation, but this is a cycle. So this name of the Poter Et Yadecha, the Rashi Tevot, is the name, one of the names of the Parnasa. So what is the meditation of the Parnasa with this Rashi Tevot? That we have the combination of the Yud Kei Vav Kei with Adni together. You see it here in the Siddur. So we bring the abundance from one Yud, the Yud of the Yud Kei Vav Kei, all the way through to the last Yud of Adni. Okay? This is another meditation. I'm saying it in short, if whoever has the Siddur in front of him can see a little bit more explanation. Then we have another, not Rashi Tevot,